And to begin, we're going to have Sarah Brody give her final talk. So please join me in welcoming her.
Well, let me just start by saying that I'm very grateful to Alan Torrance for encouraging me to give a paper at this conference. And I hope my theme or topic, which is what can it mean to hold God to be personal, is not too much to our side of the main topics of the meeting. I realized, as it were, after finishing the paper, in fact, sort of more or less 5 minutes into the first talk of this conference, that many people, possibly even the majority of people here, may well regard it as a kind of non-question, the question of God being personal. That is, by the way, I'm not, as it were, either going to attack or defend the thesis, if you like, but that is the case. It's just a question of what meaning can one give it. And I'm very much aware that the majority of people here will be people who, for whom it's so ingrained that God is personal that there really isn't almost anything there to talk about. Okay, so the paper has two parts. One of them is critical, the other one is somewhat more positive. The main target of the critical part is current analytic philosophy. It strikes me that analytic philosophy has served us rather poorly when it comes to trying to make sense of the notion that God is a personal being. This is quite surprising given two facts. The fact that analytic philosophers have in the last many decades made substantial contributions to the philosophy of religion and to philosophical theology. And secondly, the fact that the conception of God as personal is central to the religions that continue to shape so much of our thoughts in the West concerning religion, whether or not we are believers ourselves. My impression is that when the analytic philosophers have directly confronted the question of the personhood, or tonight, as it were, the personal status of God, they have answered this question much too easily. Thus, one sometimes meets an argument to the effect that the world has a first cause that is best understood as operating contingently and by free choice. And it's sometimes inferred directly from that that the cause, the first cause, must be a person and therefore must be personal on the assumption that only a person can make free choices. But it isn't obvious that free choice is a sufficient condition for being a person. An agent who chooses and could have chosen differently, but whose reasons for choosing are devoid of anything describable as in the moral dimension, seems doubtfully a person. Again, philosophers sometimes, this is another of these much too quick arguments, philosophers sometimes argue that personhood is a perfection, so that the all-perfect being must be a person. This seems to me to go much too quick. Can we be sure that a supremely perfect being is necessarily a person? Surely there have been those who held that God cannot be captured by any category, hence not by the category of person. And believers coming from a very, very different direction may be far more certain that their God is personal than that their God is a being of supreme perfection. Perhaps the main obstacle to making progress on this topic from an analytic perspective is the fact that, as far as I know, analytic philosophy has done very little to pin down the notion of the personal, by which I mean the personal as contrasted with the impersonal. For it's surely in this sense that God is held to be personal. I think that if we're trying to be rigorous on this topic, then we should not take it for granted that something is personal as opposed to impersonal, just because it fits some set of conditions that philosophers have laid out as conditions for counting as a person. Once this point is recognized, it becomes apparent that analytic philosophy has been less than helpful on the problem of this paper. It has plenty to say about personhood, in a number of philosophical contexts, but none of the discussion generated by those contexts helps us much with the question of what it is for a being to be personal, that is, as contrasted with impersonal, in a sense that could also apply to God. A case in point is the classic question of personal identity over time. Understandably, this is focused on persons such as you and me, and in line with Locke's groundbreaking discussion, it's focused particularly on the problem of what it is in virtue of which I can now be held responsible for actions done in the past. But in virtue of what is the author of Sarah Brody's 2015 tax return the same person as myself today? So if back then the wrong amount got paid, it's I today who deserve a fine or a refund. In fact, it's very unclear whether a being that fulfills all the conditions, whatever they are, for being the same person from one time to another, is automatically therefore a personal being in the sense that we're trying to illuminate. Nor is it clear that being personal in the sense we're trying to illuminate follows from being essentially a locus of moral responsibility, which is mainly what Locke is concerned with. Well, as for God, Locke had God very much in mind when he wrote on personal identity, since one of his concerns was with the last judgment, where justice requires, as does human justice, that punishment and reward be meted out to those same beings who committed the good and bad deeds. But whether God too is a person is a question does not and could not have addressed in his chapter, since here he's solely concerned with the identity through time of empirical beings. It might be said that invoking the notion of divine judgment, Locke implicitly treats God as a person and as personal, because, it might be assumed, only a personal being can exercise justice. But as a conceptual claim, this is questionable. In Greek mythology, the underworld judges Minos and Adamanthus, described in amongst other places in Plato by Plato in the Gorgias, these are surely impersonal in the sense of being what we would call reifications of impersonal principles, and similarly with the voice from heaven in the myth of Ur in Plato's Republic. If it's possible to conceive of the source of just judgment as a non-personal being, why should it not be possible to conceive of the correlates of such judgment, namely responsible agents, as also non-personal beings? The only responsible agents we really know anything about, namely ourselves, are, of course, personal beings, whatever that means. But it would be quite a philosophical leap to claim on this basis that having the status of responsible agent essentially involves being personal. Suppose, however, someone replies that the very notion of responsibility means being answerable, and whereas impersonal beings can react to stimuli, only personal ones can answer questions or demands. Okay, let us accept this, but how much does that help to elucidate the notion of a personal God? Do those who speak of a personal God really mean just that God is answerable to whom for God's actions? Moral philosophers of an analytic Kantian bent have rested much weight on the contrast between beings that are ends in themselves and should never be treated solely as means, and beings that are simply things, and it has seemed right to speak of the former as persons. Even while accepting that this distinction is of foundational moral importance, one can still ask what essential connection exists between being a person in the sense of an end in oneself and being a personal as opposed to impersonal being. I'm only too aware that this question suffers from being seriously unclear, since I haven't tried to say what I mean or what I think I mean by the term personal. But the fact one can even raise the question, as I think one can, shows that being a person, according to the Kantian distinction, that is, being an end in oneself, may not be essentially bound up with being personal as distinct from impersonal. In Kant, the status of end in oneself is an immediate consequence of rationality, but it seems precipitous to assume that being rational is what makes us personal rather than impersonal. Has anyone ever tried to argue for the personal nature of God from the premise that God is supremely rational? I just feel that argument is not going to get very far with most of us. Presumably angels are rational, although their rationality must be very different from ours. But is it completely obvious that angels, I know there are lots of different kinds of angels, so but I'm just going to treat them all together. Is it obvious that angels are personal beings? Often the named ones, sort of super angels, seem to be, as it were, embodiments of cosmic, moral, or religious principles or explanatory functions. And that seems to leave them somewhere near the impersonal end of the personal-impersonal spectrum. What is the explanatory function such that only a personal being, qua personal, can fulfill that function? This question warns us that although an explanatory function is logically a relational property of whatever occupies the functional role, the reverse implication does not hold. We are constantly told, and surely rightly, that a personal being is personal only in relation or in potential relation to one or more other personal beings, but we don't want this to tie us down to a narrow view of personal relations as simply expressing some particular kind of functionality. The Kantian focus on persons as opposed to mere things is closely connected with questions about rights, especially the right to life in difficult cases of bioethics, where the question often seems to be whether the criterion is actual or potential rationality, or maybe what I might call post-rationality. It's obviously hugely important to explore this topic, but for the moment, I shall simply point out that it doesn't seem to help with our questions of what it would mean to regard God as a personal being. Instead, it very strangely asks us to think of God, momentarily perhaps, on the model of a creature whose right to life might be violated. If anything, this seems to be the wrong way around, since people often think of the wrongness of killing in terms of the sanctity of human life, or as a desecration of the sacred. We would have made some progress towards answering the question what it means to regard God as personal if we'd somehow managed to show that sacred as such is personal, but we haven't shown this, and it may not even be true. I shall now very briefly mention the Christian doctrines of the Incarnation and the Trinity. Just as one might have expected analytical philosophical discussion of the person to shed some light on our main question, so one might have expected the same from these tenets of faith. But here too, I think we find ourselves disappointed. A layperson might think that the doctrine of the Incarnation gives a uniquely satisfying account of the personal nature of God. But first, this ignores the fact that Christianity is not the only religion whose God is intensely personal. And secondly, it risks relying on a fallacious inference from the humanity of Christ. We can take it for granted that humans are personal beings, whatever that means. Hence, of course, we therefore take for granted the personal nature of Jesus of Nazareth. But the doctrine, this is now the doctrine of the Incarnation, the doctrine by itself only tells us that God was incarnated in the form of a personal being, just as it also tells us that God was incarnated in the form of a finite, corporeal, physical being. It does not follow that the personal nature, any more than the finite corporeal nature, belongs to the nature of God as such. Furthermore, the fact that the word person or persona is traditionally used to expound the doctrine of the Trinity does not seem to shed much light on the idea of God as personal versus impersonal, or for that matter, on the persons of the Trinity as themselves personal in that sense. Of course, it is natural to think of them as personal in this sense, for what could be more personal than a father and a son? But when we recall that the second person of the Trinity is also supposed to be the eternal Logos prior to all creation, it becomes much more difficult to know where someone is coming from who states that this being is personal. Okay, that was the first part of the paper, sort of complaints about analytic, mainly about analytic philosophy. Now I start the second part. So part one surveyed a number of conceptions of or perspectives on the person and came to the negative conclusion that they don't tell us much about what it is to regard a being as personal by contrast with impersonal, and therefore do not tell us much about what this amounts to when the being in question is God. Perhaps this sort of failure is because the notion of the personal as opposed to impersonal is actually the fundamental one, and the various things that philosophers want to take from the idea of the person are actually offshoots from that more fundamental one. For what the point is worth, this is surely the order of priority in the development of knowledge. From the cradle, we are aware of personal beings as such, although that sounds a very sort of pompous way of talking about it. But from the cradle, we are aware of that long before we develop the notion of a person with its moral and legal implications. One way of putting this is, this may sound a bit paradoxical, is that even before we have verbal language, we are at home with what I'm going to call the particularized use of the second person pronoun. That is a singular pronoun normally. Like many others, I'm drawn to the idea that the personal is a fundamental category, hence a sort of primitive that cannot be analyzed further. Just now I spoke of, used the phrase the particularized use of the second person pronoun. What was the point of that piece of jargon? Well, the point is that there is a way of saying you in the grammatical singular where the speaker is not in the speech act referring to any individual. Rather, the speaker speaks to an undifferentiated and in fact merely positive audience whose members are expected to particularize the reference themselves so that each makes herself or himself the reference. The classic example is the World War I poster of Lord, in our country, Lord Kitchener. I noticed that US, there was an identical one using Uncle Sam at the very same moment in history. Lord Kitchener pointing straight at whoever is looking at the picture and with the caption, "Your country needs you." Now, here, you, the word you, functions as a variable, and we only get, just to be very slightly technical, a complete proposition or a non-open sentence when an individual looking at the poster applies the message to himself or herself. It means me. Well, in a sense that may be true, that it does mean me. But it's not true that Lord Kitchener, even if we wave for a moment, that in any case it's just a picture of him, not the real man. It's not true that Lord Kitchener or Uncle Sam addresses that individual. Instead, it's that recipient who individualizes the reference so that it's a reference to himself. He receives a message of open or indeterminate reference and makes it determinate by inserting himself as the value of that variable you. and the recipient may be well aware of what is going on, that is, aware that the message refers to him only to the extent that he does the job of applying it to himself. If he takes no notice of it, the message does not refer to him or apply to him. It seems clear that this variable second-person reference is only possible for us because we're already steeped in the practice of particularized second-person reference. That's what starts in, at, or around the cradle. And it also seems clear that this primary, inherently particularized kind that is what's in play when people pray to God or to a God, or when they find themselves being told something by God or a God. For the believer, very obviously, the Ten Commandments are not only couched in the second person singular, because this is masked in modern English, but it is the singular. Not only are they couched in the second person singular, but it is the particularized second person singular. That is, the prohibition, thou shalt not steal, does not apply to me simply because I do the job of making an independent or variable thou function as a singular term applying to me. Rather, it is God who is doing the work of assuring singular reference to each individual in the community one by one. The single form of words, thou shalt not steal, even as it issues forth from the commander, is already a bundle of as many particular commands as there are individuals in the relevant community, which of course might be worldwide. Each of these individuals has received a command that was already targeted by the source, by the commander, precisely at him or her. This, by the way, seems to be bound up with the absoluteness of the normativity of the commandment. That is, if I take no notice of Lord Kissinger's Kitchener's message, another obviously very powerful figure, if I take no notice of Kitchener's message and his pointing finger, then his utterance, your country needs you, simply doesn't apply to me, because it doesn't refer particularly to me unless I make it do so. But in many other cases, of which divine commands are just one example, the message from its inception is meant for me, amongst others. What sets the divine case off from non-divine cases in this same category is that in the latter, the being who issues the message to me or to any particular recipient may be, in fact be wrong about whether the completely particularized message does apply to me. For example, when the sentencing judge says to the prisoner, you must pay a fine of £2,000, this sentence may rest on some mistake on the part of the judge, whether a factual or a legal mistake. But with a divine command, if we believe that there is such a thing, we cannot get out of it by claiming that it rests on a mistake on the part of the commander, nor can we get out of it by treating it as a logically open sentence that does not refer to me unless I choose to make it refer to me. I think we can get a sense of what it is to regard God as personal, something at all original in what I'm now saying, by studying in connection with God the to and fro of particularized second-person utterances. There are asymmetries, as one might expect. For example, when God addresses me in the particularized fashion with a commandment or some sort of message, there is no assumption that I should take any notice, unfortunately. No assumption that I should listen to this message tailored to me. Or the addressee might say, I'll listen to it later. I tend to think this does not hold in the reverse direction. That is, when the finite being addresses God, given that there are personal beings other than God, it would seem that God is essentially a listener, or is essentially listening When someone prays, they just assume that God is interested in the same way as they just assume that God is there. All those prayerful reminders to God of divine favours conferred in the past, on our hearts, in distress, etc., those are not meant to get God to listen from non-listening, but to set up the expectation, both on our part and God's, that the anyway listening God will help us this time too, in the way that we hope. A word, by the way, may be necessary here on the meaning of listening. The full term that I'm concerned with is listening to. In English, we can be said to listen to a speech and also thereby listen to the speaker. It's in this second sense, I think, it's this second sense that indicates the personal nature of that which is being listened to. I can listen to the sound of the kettle starting to boil, but I'm not thereby listening to the cause or the source of that sound. I would be listening to whatever it is in the kettle is the source of the sound, only if I took the sound to be a communication by whatever it is that's the relevant part of the kettle. If I engage in a particularized second personal address and I'm not merely mouthing the words, then it's presupposed that someone is there listening. In many cases, I can check beforehand whether someone is there, whether they are listening, or would be aroused to listen when I start to speak, and whether it is in fact the person I want to speak to. You know, you get in the old days when we actually phoned with phones, and he was, I think, I'll still pick up as a phone, you can get the wrong person. Someone, the wrong person picks it up. Now, these procedures assume that there are ways of identifying this hour and checking whether it's the right hour, ways of identifying that precede and therefore are independent of addressing this particular other in the second person. Hence, in such cases when I do finally address him or her as you, I'm evidentially justified in taking it to be the case, first, that someone is there to receive the message, second, that they are listening, that is, in listening in the sense that they, in the sense that entails they are listening to me by listening to the message, and thirdly, that it is the right person, the one that I'm meant to be speaking to, and not someone else. Now, I tend to think that this cannot be the case, that is, it cannot be on the basis of evidential justification that we take these things to be true, when someone pray, or when we pray to God, addressing God in the second person. There is no way to verify in advance whether someone is there, is listening, and is the person whom I want to address, rather than someone else. I have to operate as if I know without finding out that everything is as it should be for my speech act to be successful, that is, a successful as an act of addressing the intended recipient, namely God. In effect, I have to operate in this limited sphere as if I myself were a divine being, that is, as if I know what I need to know without finding out. What is the situation when people pray, knowingly pray together as members of a congregation? The considerations above suggest that there is no way in which they can verify in advance of praying together that they are all addressing the same being. By saying that they pray together, I mean that they knowingly say the same prayers as each other. Thus, they operate as if they just know, without having had to find out, that they do address the same being as each other. This knowledge, or as if knowledge, that it is the same God in the shared second person address of a congregation, does not depend on their holding or believing that they hold all the same theological views about God. It seems to me that their knowledge, or as if knowledge, does not depend on anything except, as has often been said in one way or another, the act of jointly addressing God in the second person. I want to end by considering briefly what this focus on second person address may tell us about the main point of prayer. On the human level, it seems obvious that the distinctive value of communication, in which both parties operate as personal beings, I say distinctive value, is not in the end to get something done or to spread information, because in order to interact with you in those ways, I don't have to be dealing with you as a personal, by contrast with impersonal being. The distinctive value, which no other sort of activity can deliver, is on whatever level, some kind of togetherness or being with another person. The absolutely vital tasks of getting other people to do things and of spreading information are, for beings like us, also vehicles of togetherness. It's stunning to think how much of people's lively conversation is and is known by them to be almost completely empty of informational content in the sense of information gained by one or both participants. In this part of the world, the topic of the weather is usually just an excuse to chew a shared conversational cud. I don't learn any more from a weather conversation than if I'd been talking to myself, but the experience is quite different and a lot more vitalizing than telling oneself something that one already knows. So this absolutely familiar example of formulaic short chats about the weather shows that togetherness can occur and is presumably anyway often desirable without deep familiarity or commitment. It can be very shallow, but it can still be genuine. A great deal needs to be said about the conditions for including or excluding people as candidates for togetherness with oneself. With some people, I don't want to be together at all, even on a superficial level. And for others, perhaps togetherness between them and me is not possible for whatever reason. So if we attribute prayer to a desire to be in some sense with God or have God with us, there is still a large story to be told about what makes this action or interaction worthwhile and even permissible. I'm not able to go into any of that here. But from the discussion so far, we can perhaps glean the outline of a solution to a problem, or rather, it's really just one part of the problem. The general difficulty, often discussed with reference to petitionary prayer, is that of how it can make sense to pray to God if God is the God of the philosophers, that is the God of so-called classical theism. For the supremely perfect being cannot be swayed to do what it's not eternally set to do. Equally, we cannot tell it anything about ourselves or anything else that it doesn't already eternally know. But if the point of praying is above all to be in a certain way with the being addressed in the prayer, or to have the sense that this being is with us, then it simply doesn't matter that we cannot tell God anything new about anything, just as in a weather conversation. It just simply doesn't matter that neither side is finding out anything new. According to what I've tried to sketch, the believer at prayer necessarily assumes that God is there, is listening, and is interested. And interested not because the listener, God, wants to hear something from us which will increase divine knowledge of what is the case, but because whatever it is we feel impelled to say, the listener, we assume, wants to hear it as coming from us. So perhaps rather surprisingly to some of us today, treating God as personal, in the sense recipient of second personal address, does not preclude but may even help to uphold the conception of God as defined in classical theism. Thank you.
Wonderful. Well, with so many of the other speakers, I want to thank Alan Torrance and the others at the Logos Institute for inviting me. It's always a very nice reason to, nice little reason to come back to the town and university that's so very dear to me. And also very grateful to those of you who I realise I'm something of an interloper as a Old Testament scholar that you've been having these Logos conferences for many years. And I realise a Hebrew Bible scholar is a rather rare thing to see, almost as rare as seeing a wee haggis in the Highlands. thank you for putting up with me. Up till now, or at least up till last night, I rather imagined that it would be a case of I imagine myself as a Daniel amongst the lions, but having hit Malaby last night, I'm beginning to wonder whether you're going to regard me as a lion amongst the den of Daniels. I also want to thank Professor Brody for her thoughtful and, as it seems to be, very timely paper. It seems to me that the questions Sarah Brody raises, whether or not it is to the side of the main conference theme, that this question is a very important one, given the substantial contributions of analytical philosophy in recent decades. It is perhaps wise, I think, to recall that the last time that Christian thinkers enjoyed such success in directing some part of academic philosophical discourse, the end result was the deism of the late 17th and early 18th centuries. As a mere biblical scholar, I shall do my best not to swim out into historical and philosophical waters beyond my depth. You may already feel I've already done that. But it does seem to me that one of the main problems with deism from the perspective of Christian theology is its deficient views on God as personal. Now, to be sure, I realise that there is no little discussion about whether or not classical deists believe in a personal God. But that debate seems to me rather moot when the deist God has no personal interactions with his creatures. So it seems to me that if contemporary philosophical theology does not want to find itself coming to deism by perhaps a different route, it would be wise to take Sarah Brody's questions very seriously. I must also say that I really appreciate that Sarah Brody, after some careful philosophical problematizing of what we mean when we speak about God, or indeed anyone, being personal, that she comes around to thinking about God's address to us, the I and thou, and our address to God, the matter of prayer. From a theological perspective, this seems the right place to look for answers, even if it isn't the instinct of many philosophers, though my allusion to Martin Buber was no accident, and not even perhaps the instinct of many Jewish and Christian philosophers. Analytical theology that becomes decoupled from actual religious practice may be interesting, I think, for all sorts of reasons, but will soon become its own hyper-specialised academic discipline with no relevance to those who might claim to have faith. But it's at this point in the discussion of prayer that what Sarah Brody said began to conflict with my own area of academic specialism, the study of the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible. And I highlight two areas. First, her claim that God is listening and interested. I shan't say anything about the related claim, but more of an aside for Sarah Brody's argument that God is there, whatever that actually means. I avoid saying anything because of the complex and deep waters that are ingredient to Old Testament accounts of divine presence, such as saying anything in response would require quite a lot more than the 10 minutes I have allotted. Secondly, I want to say something about her insistence that prayer is about togetherness, and not about, not really about, telling God stuff he doesn't already know or asking him for something. Now, I can see all sorts of philosophical reasons why one would want to affirm these two claims, especially if you are committed to certain other beliefs about God as a perfect being. But I do think there are reasons for thinking that many of the writers of the Old Testament did not see things that way, and indeed many religious believers today do not see things that way. First, it's not apparent that God in the Old Testament is always listening and interested. The idea that gods in the Near East, who certainly were personal beings, might be attentive, or might not be attentive, is apparent in various stories. Most famously, Elijah on Mount Carmel taunts the prophets of Baal that their god must have wandered off or become neglectful. Now, for sure, the story will insist that Israel's God does hear and answer, but we may observe two things. First, that the idea that gods might be neglectful was not a terribly outlandish idea. Secondly, God does answer by fire, but Elijah does have to do certain ritual acts to ensure God's presence, repairing the altar in the prescribed manner, an essential step for ensuring the divine presence, according to Exodus 20. Without any other text to discomfort us, we might be quite content that even if other gods might be a bit neglectful of their worshippers, this was not true of Israel's God nor of ours. But other texts are not quite as helpful to discomforting them. As is well known, the priestly literature speaks of God remembering his people. And for sure, the commentaries will talk rather sagely about the linkage of thought and action. But to speak of God remembering, in the priestly literature of all places, is to imply that God does not always remember. And there are plenty of examples from the Hebrew Bible where God is sometimes portrayed as needing a little prompting from his creation, and where forgetting is predicated of God. To choose but one example from the Psalms, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? Psalm 13, verse 1. The ancient Israelites had various ways of obtaining God's attention. Sacrifice, most obviously, but also mourning rituals. The recent work by David Lambert on how repentance became biblical argues convincingly to my mind that sackcloth, fasting, and ashes were not practices of repentance, as they later came to be understood, but externalized the suffering being endured. They drew attention to suffering and made it unmissable, even by a deity. Now, perhaps C.S. Lewis was right about that suffering is God's megaphone, but in the Hebrew Bible, suffering is much more man's megaphone to get God's attention. Secondly, an awful lot of prayer in the Hebrew Bible, and indeed outside, seems rather intent on asking things of God or telling him things that he needs to know. Now, I know, because I grew up in the Reformed tradition, that Sarah Brody describes what you ought to think about prayer. But it's mighty hard to read the Psalms in that way. The psalmist seems curiously intent on asking for things from God, telling him about how bad things are, and seeking to goad him into action. Rather disconcertingly, the Psalms also give significant evidence for the practice of vows. I certainly do not think that the relationship between the deity and the worshipper are unimportant in votive practices. I've read enough on the Anthropology of the Gift to know that. But vows seem to me primarily about obtaining something. For me, the most obvious case of someone in the Hebrew Bible who is interested in a personal encounter with God is Job. But it's not so much about togetherness, but arraigning God in court and having him give an account for himself. For Job, it's personal, in every sense of that phrase. Of course, that brings us to the real problem with the Hebrew Bible for many readers, that the God of the Old Testament is often altogether too personal, too forgetful, irascible, and difficult. And one might forgive analytical philosophers for not wanting to talk about this too much. What I've said in these last few minutes is not to say that there aren't examples of thinking in the Hebrew Bible that would align rather better with Sarah Brody's arguments. Psalm 139 famously claims that God has searched and known the psalmist. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know completely. But the psalmist does rather blow it at the end by exclaiming, oh, that you would save the wicked, O Lord. Or perhaps from the perspective of analytical philosophy, this isn't a request, just what we now know is locker room banter between God and the psalmist. Anyway, it seems to me that Psalm 139 is not especially representative of the Hebrew Bible, but then the Hebrew Bible is a rather unsystematic collection of writings, and in this respect it reflects human and Christian religiosity more generally. I've already indicated that I think there are potential dangers if analytical theology becomes decoupled from actual religious practice. If the Bible and Christian practice is messy, that's just too bad for analytical theology, and something with which it will have to come to terms. And this, I take, is at least part of the point of Sarah Brody's paper, and for which I'm grateful. There is an easy path to a philosophically neat God that avoids the difficulties that God is personal. But Sarah Brody beckons us to the gate that is narrow and more challenging. And so we are promised leads to life. Thank you.
Okay, so put your hand up if you have a question. I'll start making a list, and then Andrew or our microphone will give you a microphone. Okay, we'll start with Eleanor and start the list from there.
So I thought the issue was important and I was glad that you addressed it, Sarah. And I thought that the comments highlighted, for me anyway, a question raised by your talk. And the question is, what's the methodology for answering the question you raised? That is, you ask, is God a person? And now we want to know, how should we go about answering this question? And your approach seems to be, well, we'll just reason it out. We'll ask what a person is, we'll see if that applies to God and so on. But for most people, that's an odd methodology. I mean, either you begin with revelation, in which God seems maximally personal, as the comments point out, or you begin with some sort of direct religious experience, which generally convinces most people that God is personal too. And then we have what are usually taken to be theologically authoritative statements. For example, that in Genesis, that human beings are made in the image of God, or in the New Testament, Christ saying, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, and so on. And from these authoritative, theologically authoritative statements, we also derive the conclusion that God is personal. But what we generally don't do is what you did. Just think about what we mean by the notion of a person, and then see if we somehow think that applies to God. So what I'm asking is whether you think those more familiar methodologies somehow have to be set to one side.
Okay, thank you very much. I wasn't, probably this wasn't fully clear, but I was absolutely not trying to, as it were, prove that God is or is not personal. I mean, in the current context, I sort of take it for granted that God is personal. But I do think it's quite puzzling what we, I mean, in a sense, we know exactly what we mean by that. But it's very hard to put it into, to articulate what we mean by that. And I was just saying that these various investigations in analytic philosophy about the person and so on actually seem to me to be of no use, or virtually no use, for helping us understand what we mean by God as personal. I sort of hoped that the second part of the paper, which is all this stuff about the second person singular and so forth, that this would, as it were, indicate that I think that the place to start, whether this is methodology or something more simple, but the place to start is in liturgy, prayer, and so forth, and to somehow unravel a little bit what we think is going on there.
Next is Kevin Dillard, in the back there, for sure. And then Ian is up.
Thank you very much for the paper. And so just wondering, to what extent do you think that consciousness and self-awareness are necessary for being personal? And could a single person, God, be personal without a creation on your account?
Well, I think that I'm not sure that I can really begin to answer the question about consciousness, if only because, you know, it's so sort of unclear, indeterminate, really, what counts as being conscious. Clearly there are, you know, there are phenomena of complete unconsciousness, but I think that there's lots of stuff on the borderline, and so I think I'm just not able to get into that properly. The second part, your second question was, could a God be personal, which is, if this God is the only being in existence? Was that your question?
Right, and a single person God as opposed to a Trinitarian God.
Well, it seems to me, the answer is no. As it were, completely monolithic, transcendent God prior to creation, alone in reality, as it were. This being, it seems to me, might in some sense be potentially personal, but if it doesn't choose to create, or if literally is no one else, as it were, then I'm not sure that it can be, certainly can be, actually personal.
Ian is next, followed by Fabian.
In the end of the first part of your talk, you made, I think, a good point about sort of an easy appeal to Jesus. Well, Jesus is a person, therefore God's personal is problematic. I think the points we'll take them. Jesus, what we say, Jesus' personality is as much a matter of his humanity as his being material and other sorts of things. On the other hand, one could say that about all kinds of things Jesus does, Jesus' lovingness, Jesus' wisdom, and so on and so forth, and yet Christians do want to say that somehow Jesus provides some kind of a clue about how God is. I mean, as Professor Stone said, John 14:9 and things of that sort. is there, and then the way you went on, and again, I was impressed by the second person approach, struck me as promising, but is there any way in which, I think you can't simply make Jesus your fault, you know, and sort of automatic, well, this demonstrates it, end of story. Does Jesus provide any help at all in this, as you would presumably include that? We want to say that God is loving. Part of what we understand that to mean is what we see Jesus doing, and so on and so forth. Or is it really something that where Jesus doesn't play a particular role all the way down?
Okay, my reply is constant, as it were, very limited adventuring in this area. My hunch is that Christianity would never have got off the ground if, except, I mean, for multiple reasons, this is true, but for a particular reason I'm saying, except in the context where God, that is the pre-Christian God, is already without any difficulty regarded as personal, okay? Only in that context could anyone even begin to suppose that God is also a human person. Yeah. Secondly, I would have thought that Jesus, in some sense, for Christians, fills in somewhat the outline, fills in the outline, so that he has the effect, or his life had the effect, of showing people more in more detail, like what sort of person God is. It's already being, as it were, assumed that God is a person. But I think that's how I would see it, rather than, as it were, Jesus proving ab initio that God is personal.
Right. Right, oh, could you please say your name and where you're from? I forgot my name.
Yes, good morning. Thank you very much for your stimulating paper. Fabian Grassi from the International Academy of Philosophy in Liechtenstein. On page 3, you say, quote, that a personal being is personal only in relation or in potential relation to one or more other personal beings, end quote. So the meaning of person necessarily implies the plural. But I think we have some interesting implications here for the Islamic doctrine of Tawhid. For in Islam, Lord Allah is strictly and necessarily one. And I wonder, therefore, are we justified then to speak of Allah as being personal? Now we might say Allah is potentially personal in relation to his creation, but then we would make him dependent on creation. So I wonder whether you could briefly comment on that.
Well, I think a lot depends on whether you think that Allah, as it were, had something like the plan of creation all along, even in whatever exactly this means, prior to the act of creation. In that case, the real possibility of personal interaction with created beings, in a sense, is guaranteed. Yeah, and to that extent, God or Allah may be said to be personal even from the very beginning. I don't know whether that satisfies you, if what you want rather is an account of Allah such that even had he chosen not to create, right, he nonetheless, if he is personal, would have been equally personal, okay? That I think is much more difficult.
There's a woman in back, blonde hair, I'm sorry, I forgot your name. The woman behind that gentleman.
Thank you, and it's Stephanie Nordby. So I can't decide if this question is beating a dead horse at this point, but I like the sound of my own voice, so I'm going to ask it anyways. Really liked, I mean, I like obviously both parts of your paper, but in particular, some of the reasoning you go through in the first half. And I am someone who's very interested in the incarnation qua revelation, so the comments you make about where inference can go wrong in reasoning from the incarnation to the nature of God, I think is really important, really interesting. What I wonder, though, is that I wonder if we can help ourselves to sort of more premises in thinking about what implications incarnation has for how we think about the nature of God than what you mentioned here. So it seems to me that a lot of biblical scholars, New Testament scholars, are going to want to say, or theologians are going to want to say something like, look, not only do we have the God-man to look at as in some important way embodying God, but also that in fact, because he's this logos, there's a way in which we can think that we are made in the image of Christ. And so, and some of the esteemed people here have written papers on that very issue, the idea that maybe there's nothing about humanity in and of itself that is so opposite to the nature of God, such that the incarnation is actually a very natural thing to have happened. So I wonder if you can help yourself to that, or I hesitate to raise this, and Tim Paul's looking at me, but even thinking about attributive analogy and things like that to maybe help yourself to more in making inferences from Christ back to the nature of God in general, especially given the history of religious tradition where it seems like there's these overwhelming religious voices saying that, no, God seems to disclose himself in personal ways. So I was just wondering if you could say more about that.
Well, you know, there are many, there have been many different religions, and perhaps in the majority of them, I don't know, God or the gods are, as it were, encountered both in some sense personally and intellectually as personal beings. So depending on someone's religious perspective, they will perhaps want to flesh that out in their own way, according to their own tradition. Okay. It's clear, obviously, that the God of the Hebrew Bible is personal, yeah, 100% personal. Whether he was personal on the first day of creation, well, we already basically discussed that. I've said as much as I can on that at this moment. In the pagan so-called religion, you know, you read some poems, prayer poems, like Sappho's Ode to Aphrodite and so on. She just takes it for granted that the goddess is a person. Yeah. So this is a very natural way for humans in general to think when thinking religiously. I'm not saying that every religion involves personal deity or even a deity at all, but I just think that the question that you asked is a question where, if one is a Christian, then that would doubtless be a natural way to go, the way that you suggested. But it's obviously not inevitable, because Christianity, as I said in the paper, is certainly not the only religion that posits a personal God.
All right, well, thank you very much. Before you clap, just a reminder, we're coming back to this room at 11:30. There's coffee and tea, fit that way. Come out of that room, congregate in here or in the quad just next door. And now let's thank our speakers. Thank you.